A study this morning for this quarter. I don't know how long it'll take, but the study's on the Sermon on the Mount, and I wanted to preface what I'm going to be saying, prefacing the study of the Sermon on the Mount with some comments on the kingdom of God. Now, those who've been in my classes through the years, you've heard me teach on this because I think it's very important. Not only is it important as background and context for the Lord's teaching in the Sermon on the Mount, but it's important for much of New Testament theology. It is a very important. So I figure if you've heard me teach on this before, we'll just take this as reinforcement. And then there's some of you that I'm sure have not heard me teach on this particular subject. But the kingdom is, of course, it's a large subject, and I want to outline it here. And it begins in the beginning, that God in the beginning miraculously created all the various kinds. He created all things, including human beings, Adam and Eve, during the 6 days of creation. And creation was, at first, it was an ideal place in which all things were acting in the way God desired. There was this wonderful peace and harmony. But soon, Adam and Eve, who were to be God's representatives on earth, they rejected his rule by disobeying him. And by bringing sin into the human world, they contaminated or spoiled God's very good creation. As a result, creation is not now the way it's supposed to be. It's no longer a paradise in which all things work together in peace and harmony under God's rule. Instead, our world now includes things like anger and hatred and violence, and destruction, and death, and decay, and lying, and stealing, and sorrow, and pain. In that sense, creation is sick as a result of sin. It has fallen from its original state of glory, which why in Christian theology Adam's sinning is known as the fall. Now, the Bible story, as we looked at last year, we were looking at the story. The Bible story is the story of God's work through the people of Israel to rescue his creation, which includes mankind. But it's the story of his work to rescue creation from its fallen state. People are the high point of God's creation. But his rescue effort includes all of creation, because all of creation was harmed as a result of sin. That's why Paul says in Romans chapter 8, verses 19 to 23, that creation itself looks forward to the day it will be freed from the consequences of human sin. Creation itself is looking forward to this redemption and this freeing from this bondage to corruption. And the scope and the breadth of Christ's healing, that it involves all things in heaven and on earth. The scope and breadth of Christ's healing can also be seen in Colossians 1, 19 to 20, where Paul speaks of Jesus as the one through whom God the Father reconciled all things to himself. All things, whether things in heaven or things on earth, through Christ's blood shed on the cross. It's also seen in Ephesians 1, especially verses 9 and 10, where Paul says that the mystery of God's will for the administration or the outworking of the fullness of times is to bring all things together in Christ, the things in the heavens and the things on earth. As he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 20, for all the promises find their yes in him. Jesus is the one who reconciles all things to the Father. Now, the Old Testament, it ends on a note of unfulfilled hope. It ends on this note of unfulfilled hope. It was clear, and has always been clear, that in one sense, God has always ruled the world from the time of creation. You see that God's on his heavenly throne, and that God reigns over all. So there is a sense in which God has always ruled creation, but there was some sense in which his kingly rule has not yet been fully expressed, fully asserted, you see, fully exerted. There is some sense that he's allowing creation to go on out of step with his ultimate intention for it. He's allowing it to continue in a state of sin and suffering that's contrary to his ultimate purpose and vision. So he's sovereign over all, but there is a sense in which he's not fully expressing his sovereignty because he's allowing this to go on. But this is contrary to his ultimate vision. But the prophets, you see, the prophets saw that a day was coming in which God would express his sovereignty, would express his rulership of creation in such a way that all things would be brought into harmony and conformity with his ultimate will and purpose. His creation would be redeemed from the dreadful consequences of sin that had invaded it. This world of rebellion, this world of sin, this world of hostility, this world of fragmentation would be rescued by God, would be transformed by him into a true utopia, this perfect reality of love, joy, and fellowship with God and one another. See, on that day, God would express his authority over creation in a way that he's not doing at present. He would, in his sovereign power, bring creation to its ultimate fulfillment. See, at that time, as it says in Zechariah, at that time he will be king. You say, wait a minute, he's always sovereign. I know that. But there is a sense in which he's not fully expressing the sovereignty like he will ultimately. He's allowing it to go on, but there is a time when he will be king in that fullest sense. And this is what Zechariah is speaking about in a manner unlike the present. Robert Saucy is a New Testament a theologian. He writes in the chapter, The Eschatology of the Bible, in the Expositor's Bible Commentary. He says, according to the scriptures, there's a sense in which God has always ruled and is even now the king over all creation. Who could deny it, right? But there's another thread of truth that views the kingdom as yet to come. Zechariah 14:9, Matthew 6:10, which we'll talk about when we get to the Sermon on the Mount. It is this last theme that dominates the eschatological hope of Scripture. While God rules over the affairs of the earth with nothing occurring apart from his permissive will, he has allowed sin and rebellion to enter history and Satan to have a certain dominance as the God of this age. God's rule might be said, therefore, to be over the earth, but not directly on the earth. Now, you could quibble with how he phrases that, but you get the idea. It is the coming of God to establish this latter condition, to bring his kingdom to earth in the vindication of his sovereign holiness that has constituted the hope of God's people throughout all time. It is this full and final expression of his authority and sovereignty where he's going to heal the sick creation. He's going to right all the wrongs and bring all things into peace and harmony. I. Howard Marshall is a very well-known New Testament scholar. He says in his book, Jesus the Savior, he says, the kingdom of God is the full and powerful manifestation of the sovereignty that God already exercises over the world. That's what I'm trying to communicate to you. That God is sovereign over all things, but he's allowing sin and rebellion to go on, that there's a day coming from this point, you see, when he says here that the full and powerful manifestation of his sovereignty, he's going to fully exert that. This is what people were looking forward to. Daryl Bach, who's another New Testament scholar, Bach says, the kingdom of God as Jesus used it is not about the inherent sovereignty of God as creator. He's always sovereign, right? Rather, it treats the idea of his promised redeeming rule expressed afresh in the world in the arrival of a newly dawning age of shalom. That's peace, harmony, reconciliation. You see, this has always been the vision of God's people, longing for that day, longing for that time, longing for that true divine utopia where all things will be made right. You see, in other words, the kingdom of God is in one significant sense, it's the end game of the Bible story. It refers to that full and ultimate expression of God's sovereignty over creation, that state of existence that is also known elsewhere as the new heavens and the new earth. Now, the Old Testament, it uses different imagery to refer to this blessed state that God is going to create. And the imagery varies in how sharply it contrasts that state from the present, in how radically it portrays the differences. But all of these images say, in language that would be relevant to ancient Jews, that a time of divine blessing is coming. It says that the failures and the sufferings of the present age would be put to rights by the coming of the new age. So all of these things picture that. Sometimes you see this. Sometimes the Old Testament images this state as the restoration of Israel to greatness, of the coming of a new king like the great King David. Sometimes it speaks of God's healing the world's sicknesses and hatreds, of God's people being freed from oppression, of renewed prosperity and justice for the poor, of war and the weapons of war being abolished, death being swallowed up and tears being wiped away, alienation between God and man being removed, God's Spirit being poured out in a new way, and a new heaven and a new earth, which is perhaps the most radically discontinuous from the description of present. You see, it speaks of those, and you can see those in Isaiah and Jeremiah and Daniel and Amos and Micah and Joel. These different pictures and different images. Now, in the first century, Israel in the first century was weak, poor, and under the rule of pagans. Graham Goldsworthy writes in his book, According to Plan, The Return from Exile. Remember Babylonian exile? They come back in 536, 6th century B.C., He says the return from exile results in only a pale shadow of the predicted glorious kingdom for the people of God. Thomas Schreiner, who's a New Testament scholar, he says in his book, is his New Testament theology, he says the prophets promised a new creation, a new temple, a new covenant, a new king. The exile would be over and the wilderness would bloom. The great promises in the prophets, however, were not fulfilled when the exile ended in 536 B.C. Israel did not return from Babylon, and a temple was built, yet the temple was insignificant in comparison to the Solomonic temple. Nor was the nation enjoying glorious prosperity, the kind of glory envisioned in Isaiah 40 through 66. Israel was small, struggling, and under the oppression of former powers. Ezra, Nehemiah, Haggai, Zechariah, and Malachi document the low spiritual state of the nation. Nor did matters improve in the 400 years before the coming of Jesus of Nazareth. Israel was a pawn in the struggle between the Ptolemies and the Seleucids, intertestamental period. A brief period of freedom dawned with the Hasmoneans in the second and first centuries B.C., but the interlude was brief. And soon the Romans swept in and subjugated Israel, appointing the Herodians and procurators to rule the land. This is the state of Israel in the first century, and the people longed and prayed for the coming of the kingdom of God, for his final intervention, when he would set all things right and would rule in the fullest sense to the blessing of his people. You remember in Mark 15, 43, Joseph of Arimathea, he's described as one who's what? Waiting for the kingdom of God. He's waiting for this intervention. He's waiting for this state when God will set all things right. And it was into that religious, that social, and that political environment that Jesus came saying, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Mark chapter 1. But if it is by the Spirit of God that I cast out demons, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. Matthew 12, 28. For behold, the kingdom of God is among you. Luke 17, 21. Jesus made that same point in a number of his parables. For example, the point of the parable of the bridegroom in their midst. is that Jesus, he says, they do not fast in the current period, because the current period is like the celebration of a wedding feast when the groom is present. See, something exciting, something important. So when the groom is present, and the joyful and significant thing that is taking place in Jesus' ministry is the ushering in of this long-awaited kingdom of God. That's why he tells the disciples in Matthew 13, 17, For truly I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it. And to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. They all had this idea, they were looking for it, but they didn't see it. They didn't hear it. And the kingdom is all over Christ's preaching. You see here the good news of the kingdom. Matthew 4:23, went about Galilee, teaching in their center, preaching the good news of the kingdom. Mark 9:35, proclaiming the gospel of the kingdom. Luke 4:43, the good news of the kingdom. Luke 8:1, the good news of the kingdom. 9:2, proclaim the kingdom of God. Luke 9:60, proclaim the kingdom of God. You see, this is the thing. This is the dominant message of Jesus. He comes and he says, the kingdom of God is at hand. He is bringing in what all these prophets and righteous people had longed for in the past. He's the one who's doing it. The good news of the kingdom was that the kingdom was at long last arriving in the person and ministry of Jesus. He was the kingdom bringer. He's the kingdom bringer. He's announcing the arrival of God's final intervention in history, the ultimate expression of God's kingly rule. David Wenham, who taught New Testament at Oxford University for 24 years, David Wenham says, to sum up, in proclaiming the kingdom of God, Jesus was announcing the coming of God's revolution and of God's new world as promised in the Old Testament. God was at last intervening, Jesus declared, to establish his reign over everything, to bring salvation to his people and renewal and reconciliation to the world. Well, this announcement created excitement. This created excitement in some quarters, but it also created suspicion and opposition in other quarters. And it also led to misunderstanding. And it led to misunderstanding because of incorrect ideas that were circulating among the Jews about the coming and the nature of the kingdom of God. And the Lord addressed those misunderstandings about the coming and nature of the kingdom of God in his teachings in various ways. Many Jews, they thought that the kingdom would arrive through or in conjunction with human military conquest, or more specifically, through the expulsion of the Romans and their supporters from Palestine. You remember in John 6:15, where it says that some were about to take Jesus by force and make him king. Well, why is that? That is because in their mind, the coming of this kingdom was somehow tied up with a political conquest and rulership, that would be the catalyst for God's final intervention. You see, so they want to come and they make him king. In their mind, see, it was in that role of a political king that would be the means or the catalyst of the kingdom's arrival. But as Wenham points out, he says, Jesus had in mind a bigger revolution than that. God's revolution was to be a total revolution, overthrowing Satan and evil and bringing earth and heaven back in harmony. And this would not be accomplished by force of arms, but unbelievably, so far as the disciples were concerned, and who blames them? Through suffering and death. So one of the things is that they're looking for this exaltation, for this assertion of political power, of military might, of sending these people out, and Jesus corrects that. But they also expected the kingdom to come suddenly and decisively. They expected this intervention, this final work, this kingdom to come suddenly and decisively. They thought God's final intervention would be a one-shot deal, the day of the Lord, where the old age would be terminated abruptly. And the new age, the glorious age, would begin. You remember in Luke 19:11, where the people supposed that the kingdom of God would appear immediately upon Jesus' arrival in Jerusalem. And this aspect of their thinking has been diagrammed this way. This was a common Jewish expectation and understanding of the coming kingdom, was that you have the old age, you have the day of the Lord, and that's it, and now we're in the new age. You see, is this one-shot deal. And this expectation that they had, this caused people to wonder, how can Jesus be ushering in the kingdom? How can he be ushering in the kingdom when the hallmarks of the old age, death, sin, suffering, decay, when they're still present? How can he be saying this, that he's bringing the kingdom and we still see the old age, when we understand that the kingdom comes and that's it for the old age? You remember even John the Baptist, right? He began to question as he sat in Herod's jail whether Jesus was in fact the one who would bring the kingdom. John began to wonder, look, Jesus, I mean, you're here. Why am I still languishing in this sinner's jail? Why am I being treated this way? And he began to wonder. Jesus explained in a number of parables and elsewhere that the kingdom comes in two stages. It is introduced or inaugurated, then there is an interval of time, and then there is the decisive intervention when the kingdom is consummated or finalized. This is clear, for example, in the parable of the seed growing secretly in Mark 4, the parable of the mustard seed in Matthew 13, the parable of wheat and weeds in Matthew 13. Samuel Mikulski writes in his chapter, The Theology of the New Testament, he says, while Scripture recognizes the reign of God as being eternal, it acknowledges that his sovereignty in the evil-infected world is only partial, meaning partially expressed. He's sovereign over all. Nothing occurs apart from his permissive will, but he's allowing it to go on until he fully asserts that sovereignty, as I've talked about. Scripture declares that God's universal reign will be achieved at Christ's second advent, his return. This reign, however, has already broken into history in the incarnation, death, resurrection, and ascension of Christ. Preben Vang and Terry Carter say in their book, Telling God's Story, according to Jesus, the kingdom of God is already here. It's a present reality. Jesus inaugurated it. The age to come has broken into the present age. God is making his presence felt already now. Yet the kingdom of God is not here in full. Evil still exists. God does not yet fill all in all. This will only happen at the time of the consummation when Christ comes back. We now live between the times. The promised age to come has already begun, but it is not here in full. The old age is still here as well. This is important. I've told people before, I would have paid to have somebody tell me this when I was a young Christian. It took a long time and a lot of detours. Okay, now whether you, I don't know what you think of it, but I'm telling you, I would have paid early on to have somebody tell me this. This is diagrammed this way. Do you see Jesus coming as he inaugurates and brings in the kingdom? But then we have the old age of Satan continues in a sense, they overlap until Christ's second coming, when all that is contrary to the eternal vision of God is then stripped out and the kingdom of God is the sole reality. This is it, you see. And this is something that's important. And we have texts in addition to the parables that indicate that God's kingdom is a present reality, that it has been ushered in, it has been inaugurated, it has been initiated, it has been instituted. We have texts in addition to the parables that say the kingdom is a present reality between the first and second comings of Christ. And you see here, but we have other texts that likewise indicate, in addition to parables, that the kingdom is a future hope. So there's a sense in which it's a present reality, but there's also a sense in which it's a future hope. There is a sense in which it is now. There's a sense in which it is not yet. See, that's important. That's important. And you see this same now and not yet aspect characterizes other kingdom-related concepts. You see, for example, eternal life. There is a sense in which we have eternal life now. But there is another sense in which it's still to come. There is a sense in which the end of the ages is now. But there is a sense in which the end of the ages is still to come. There is a sense in which redemption is now, but there's a sense in which it's still to come. There's a sense in which salvation is now, but there's a sense in which it's still to come. Adoption is now, still to come. Death's defeat, now, still to come. New creation, now, still to come. You see, there's this tension. There's this overlap of ages from that diagram, that there is this present reality that is now, but there is a sense of fuller completion. You see, a sense of fuller completion that will be experienced when the kingdom that was inaugurated is finalized or consummated at Jesus' return. The inauguration of the kingdom, this involved a complex of events that are viewed as a single unit. It's like this complex that's a block, a single unit. You see, the kingdom was ushered in through the life and ministry of Jesus, through his death, resurrection, and ascension, and through the outpouring of the Spirit on the day of Pentecost. That's why Jesus could say before the cross and before Pentecost that the kingdom has come upon you. It has come upon you. That's why he could say the kingdom of God is among you. In Luke 17, 21, see, the process of inauguration was underway, a process that would run through the events of Pentecost. So this idea, there's this inauguration, but that is a complex of events that are seen as a unit. Let me quote to you Robert Stein. He's an evangelical scholar. This is in the Evangelical Dictionary of Biblical Theology. Robert Stein says, "The kingdom of God is both now and not yet." And people who've known me for a long time, they laugh when they hear this because I've said this so many times in my life. You see, they're over here ready to fall asleep going, "Not again." But this is important. He says, "The kingdom of God is both now and not yet. Thus, the kingdom of God is realized and present in one sense and yet future in another sense. This is not a contradiction, but simply the nature of the kingdom. The kingdom has come in fulfillment of the Old Testament promises. A new covenant has been established, but its final manifestation and consummation lie in the future. Until then, we are to be good and faithful servants." This is how we are to live in this overlap of ages as kingdom participants. We are to live faithful lives. You say, "Well, what's this all have to do with the Sermon on the Mount?" Do you see? The Sermon on the Mount is going to give us, how are you called to live as disciples, as kingdom participants? How are you called to live in this overlap of ages? What kind of people are we to be? And it also has other implications for that I'll point out as we go along. Now, it's at Christ's return. It's at his return that the redemption he began nearly 2,000 years ago will come to completion. See, this is the time when in Revelation chapter 11, verse 15, the heavenly voices say, "The kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of his Christ, and he shall reign forever and ever." You go, "Wait, well, I understand. Isn't the kingdom now?" Yes, it is. Hasn't he been sovereign all the time? Yes, he has. But there is a sense of fullness about this, and it is that sense to which the inspired writer is appealing when he says in 11:15, "The kingdom of the world has become." In this fuller sense of consummation, the kingdom has become. You see, this is the time when in Revelation chapter 11, verse 17, the 24 elders, they say, "We give thanks to you, Lord God Almighty, who is and who was, for you have taken your great power and what? And begun to reign." Well, God reigns all the time. I know that. Do you see? I know that. I'm trying to get you to see that there is another sense of expression of this reigning. That is what is being spoken of here. He's begun to reign in that fuller, complete sense of the consummation of the kingdom, in which the kingdom of God is the sole reality. It is that state or that reality where all things are working. It's that divine utopia. It's what we long for. It's what we want to have. At Christ's return, the kingdom that he inaugurated at his first coming will be consummated or finalized. And it's at Christ's return that the children of God will receive glorious resurrection bodies. Okay? Resurrection bodies. The resurrection is not about the mere post-death survival of soul and spirit. It is about a return to bodily life. As N.T. Wright phrases it, it's about life after death. You see, it's about life after death. Life after death is a disembodied spiritual existence, but resurrection is about the bodily life that comes after that. So we will be raised. And that's part of what happens here at this consummation. See, this is the new heavens and the new earth that you read about in Isaiah, that you read about in 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 13, in Revelation chapter 21, verse 1, especially 21, 1 to 4. You see this tremendous, glorious picture that is given to us of the consummated kingdom. See, this reality, this creation, this sin-sick world that is marred by fragmentation, suffering, sin, all of that. This creation will be heavenized. This creation is going to be heavenized. It is going to be redeemed. What you saw in Romans 8, where Paul said creation is longing for this redemption, it will participate and share in this redemption in a way that is analogous to how we will be resurrected. We will be transformed. We will be suited for eternity. All of creation is getting that makeover. It is going to be heavenized. You see, life will go on in this new heaven and new earth, in this transformed creation, in perfect and perpetual harmony with God's ultimate intent. It will be a reality. It will be an existence like just mind-blowing. Just mind-blowing. And people sometimes say, well, you know, what are you going to do all the time? You're going to get bored. I try to tell people with kind of a goofy analogy or illustration by telling them, look, you know, sometimes if you've heard people who are on drugs, how they got hooked or something, or using some drugs, and they say, the first time they say, man, I got to a place I never wanted to leave. All right. You get some of the idea. It's not going to be a thing to say, well, you know, this is really a drag. I'm tired of being here. That's not going to happen. It is going to be absolute, complete fulfillment. And it will be this perfect reality of love and joy, no ulterior motives, no worrying about people, you know, angling, none of that. Just hugging all family in the deepest sense, loving, celebrating, living. And I just tell you, you know, I see what our world talks about, Bruce Jenner and this kind of stuff, and I'm looking here. I'm saying, we got this to talk about. And all we can focus on is that. Of course, that has spiritual overtones. I'm aware of that. Here's what N.T. Wright says. N.T. Wright, I assume, he's just a very well-known theologian. He says, God made heaven and earth. At the last, he will remake both and join them together forever. And when we come to the picture of the actual end in Revelation 21 and 22, we find not ransomed souls making their way to a disembodied heaven, which is how much, you know, has gone on so much. I've told you before, when I first was talking decades ago, I was teaching a class of young kids at church, and these guys have been raised in the church, they never heard this. I'm thinking, what do you mean you never heard of this? This is basic Orthodox Christianity. No, never heard that.
I'm
going, okay, well, you're hearing it now. All right, it says, and we come to the picture of the actual in Revelation 21:20. We find not ransomed souls making their way to a disembodied heaven, but rather the new Jerusalem coming down from heaven to earth, uniting the two in a lasting embrace. This is what I'm trying to get across with this idea of heavenized. You see, this broken, sin-sick, this decaying creation that has been damaged because of human sin, it too is redeemed and it's heavenized. And that is the reality in which we will live forever. Now, at his first coming, Jesus not only announced the kingdom's arrival, but he also demonstrated the kingdom's character. And he gave us a foretaste of it. As John Piper says in a sermon titled Christ and Cancer, he says, the answer to why Jesus did not raise all the dead, because that comes up sometimes. People say, why didn't he raise all the dead? I love these people trying to, condemn Jesus. You know, these people are doing whatever they're doing. They're looking at Jesus. Well, if he was really something, he would have done all that. All right. He says, the answer to why Jesus didn't raise all the dead is that contrary to the Jewish expectation, remember I showed you the diagram? Okay. The first coming of the Messiah was not the consummation and full redemption of this fallen age. The first coming was rather to purchase that consummation, illustrate its character, and bring a foretaste of it to his people. Therefore, Jesus raised some of the dead to illustrate that he has the power and one day will come again and exercise it for all of his people. See, you see, it's an illustration of the consummation that he's going to come and raise the dead. And he healed the sick to illustrate that in his final kingdom, that's how it will be. There will be no more crying or pain or suffering or hurting. The old order of things has passed away. This is where we're headed. The intermediate state where we will exist as spirit, disembodied spirits, is itself a blessed state. Okay, so that's comforting and reassuring for people who die before. It is itself a blessed state. But it is not the end. It is not the end. The end is the resurrection. You see, the end is the resurrection where we will live. Now, to round things out, let me say that I think we often have not been precise enough in talking about the relationship of the church and the kingdom. I think we haven't been precise enough. The two are closely related, but we oftentimes conflate them as though there's no distinction between them. You know, they're not that way. The kingdom of God is this full expression of God's sovereignty. It is a sphere and a state in which God fully expresses his sovereignty over creation so that he brings all things into this harmony with his ultimate intention. You see, now we are kingdom participants. God has invaded and there's this revolution going on where Jesus comes and he pulls the not yet into the now. He pulls that age into the present age so that we're in this overlap. And we are those who surrender and submit to this working of God. We are kingdom participants. But the kingdom concept itself is broader than that. It is this larger working of God, you see, in expressing his sovereignty. So I just think we get into trouble sometime with that. I think George Ladd, in his book, A Theology of the New Testament, George Ladd, I could have given you half a dozen quotes of similar import, but I know how some of you don't like it when I quote people like this, but some of it I have to do. I could either just steal their ideas and not let you know where I got them, or I can read it. Okay, and so I prefer to let you see the people I'm stealing from. All right, so here's George Ladd. He says, the kingdom is primarily the dynamic reign. You see that you get it from kingdom? You see, it's primarily the dynamic reign or kingly rule of God, and derivatively, the sphere in which the rule is experienced. In biblical idiom, the kingdom is not identified. It's not the same as its subjects. They are the people of God's rule who enter it, live under it, and are governed by it. The church is the community of the kingdom. So they're intimately related. But I just think at times we haven't been precise enough. You see, they're intimately related. He says the church is the community of the kingdom, but never the kingdom itself. Jesus' disciples belong to the kingdom as the kingdom belongs to them, but they are not the kingdom. The kingdom is the rule of God. The church is a society of men, redeemed men and women. You see, so I think this is something that I hope that's of some value to you. Now, why am I going through all this? Well, I like it for one thing. I mean, I like the opportunity to share it and to reinforce the things that I've said before. But it's important generally, you see, it's important generally just because this is a massive thing in New Testament theology. It is there in Paul's teaching. It is everywhere. You need, I think, to understand this framework to correctly understand a great deal, and certainly to understand my approach to the Sermon on the Mount. There are a lot of different approaches to the Sermon on the Mount, and I won't bore you with all those. But my approach to the Sermon on the Mount is one of inaugurated eschatology. In other words, it is one that is very conscious of this fact that the kingdom in some sense is a present reality and has been inaugurated, but in another sense awaits fulfillment. You see, that way when we look at all of these ethical requirements that God is placing on people, you say, well, how do they fit in? I struggle with these. This is a mighty high calling. This is the ideal of a Christian, and this is the target of our lives. We can't blow these things off as some people do and say, well, listen, you can't live that way, so the whole point of the Sermon on the Mount is to show you how bad you are so that you'll turn to grace. Okay? Turning to grace is important. But these are ethical calling. That is why this kingdom, you see, it is so radical. And we are the participants of this in this kingdom, and so we are called to radically righteous lives. Now, the fact that it is now and not yet means that we won't fully express or live out these high ethical requirements until we share in that ultimate transformation. You see, that's important. So that as you and I set these as goals, as Christian callings, this is how we're to live, radical as they are, this is how we are to live, but then we're at peace as we fail. Why? Because our living this way does not earn us or achieve us anything, right? We live this way because the one who bought us and redeemed us has called us to glorify him in this world by living this way. So as we fail, knowing that we will until we share in that finalization, knowing that we're going to limp, knowing that we don't use that to then say, I don't care about this calling. I'm not going to struggle to be this righteous. I'm not going to call other people to be this way. No, we're all in. But as we fail, we're not spiritually neurotic about it, because we are not building a ladder or earning anything through this, right? We are at peace, we get up, and we keep working, and we call one another. Glorify our Savior. Live this way. Be this beacon in this dark world of people who've been redeemed by Jesus Christ. And what people look at us and say, who are these people? That's part of the problem of what's happened in the world, right? How did the church grow so much? The church grew so much because it was outstanding. In the sense that people looked and they said, who are these people? Look at how they love each other. They're willing to take somebody who's not family member, blood, and they're willing to take them and spend the money to have them buried, which was a big thing. Who would do that? Well, they would. Why? Because they've all been bought by the same blood. They are brothers and sisters, and they live that way. You see? So this is how it's relevant. So you'll see as we go through these things, you haven't heard the last of this, though you may wish you had. All right. I heard the bell. Thanks for coming.